Hey guys.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Good.
Is there not a concern that as we raise, you know, our debt limit here, that that could hamper future councils, or that you get close to, I guess, getting a downgrade from the credit agencies? Is there not a concern the more debt we take on, though, there is a problem going forward?
Well, I'll let more specific questions on that be answered by our finance chair. I will say that the fact that we have a debt strategy is something that is somewhat unique, and it's something that I'm very pleased that we have, because what it has done in this case is allowed us to work with our administration and our CFO to address those concerns in terms of credit and you know, what makes sense from a financially responsible perspective.
Is a $60 billion promise of infrastructure a fund enough, or do you still need that guaranteed every year revenue stream that you've been and other mayors have been calling for? Because I asked Mr. Trudeau during that during the campaign, it was, oh, this is a lot of money and there'll be some, you know, guaranteed streams in there, but it's still a fund at the end of the day. It's not what you and the mayors have been asking for.
Well, I mean, let's wait and hear from the new government of Canada in terms of how they're going to implement that before we get into the weeds too much. Right now, we do need to hear from them on how they plan on implementing that campaign commitment, and we'll be ready to collaborate with them and give them our thoughts on what makes sense for Winnipeg in terms of its implementation.
Are you concerned at all, though, that borrowing more might lead to future credit rating downgrades? So far, the city's been given a, you know, some approval by the credit ratings and just sort of blamed for its affiliation with the province when it was downgraded recently.
Well, I'll let our finance chair speak to that more directly, but we have worked with our administration and our CFO on addressing those questions as well. So I think our finance chair will have to say that.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, let's think about this practically. I get a call from MasterCard once every 2 or 3 months, and they say, you know what, we're going to increase your credit limit because you're such a good guy and you pay your bills on time. But that's not necessarily a prudent thing to do. Just because they're going to offer it, or because currently rates are low.
I would never suggest you, Sean, oversimplify something. But let's talk this through. Credit card debt is a little bit differently because the one thing I will note is that these are fixed borrowing costs on record low interest rates, and we do have serious needs for investment in infrastructure, and one of the most notable projects that this change will likely benefit is the Waverly Underpass, and that's something that's very important to Winnipeggers, and we want to take advantage of record low interest rates in order to address the infrastructure needs of our growing city.
Okay. Does the ability to raise the limit help with your future goal of building all of this bus rapid transit? Does that factor into this at all?
It factors into infrastructure renewal.
But this, Mr. Mayor, if you're taking on more debt, that's going to be greater debt repayment, and that's sort of going to limit what you're going to be able to do with the tax revenue next year and in subsequent years. Are you not leaving less money available for cash, for projects to do cash, because all your money now is going to pay off debt?
Well, let's be clear about what this motion does and what it doesn't do. It's a self-imposed council mandate on a debt ceiling, for starters. It doesn't make the decisions on a case-by-case basis. The council will make on which projects are worthy of incurring debt. And those decisions will be made on key infrastructure projects on a case-by-case basis and consistent with the direction provided by council in our budgets.
Could you do the waiver of the underpass without doing this? Without doing this, does that really make it harder to do?
I'll leave questions in terms of some of the details to our finance chair, who is here, and we'd be happy to answer specific questions on that motion.
The report, just one on the debt load, because the report says in 2014 it was $943 million. It expects to grow to $1.72 billion in 2023. Is there any concern if that's too much for the city?
Well, like I just said, I'll leave specific questions on this to our finance chair, who's here and happy to answer questions.
Okay. Should we move on? Good? Good?
Sure.
And we should pick off some of these things. All right, you had a new initiative today on standing committees. So we're going to see a realignment of such.
Yeah.
I guess, first and foremost, describe your goals, dreams, and aspirations for a standing committee on innovation.
Well, thanks for the question. We've had a year to see what's working and what can be improved. And innovation is really through an ad hoc committee right now that's not a full standing committee. We need to prioritize it. It's something I spoke about during the campaign, and it will provide us with increased focus and consistency of meetings for innovation. As you know, in the last budget, we introduced a $1 million capital innovation fund to allow for strategic investments in efficiencies and innovation in the public sector. This standing committee, if approved by council, will move to a full standing committee on specifically on innovation. So it's something that is a realignment with the priority that Winnipeggers gave us in the last election.
There's more responsibility in that committee, right? It's going to take over. Well,
Alternative service delivery does is responsible, and that won't change in terms of the SOAs. As special operating agencies, and so that will not change.
Okay.
The name will be changed to innovation. It will move to a full standing committee, which will mean more regular meetings and increased focus. I'm also very pleased to propose pulling out of IRPW the water and waste, and making water and waste, riverbank management, and the environment a full standing committee on its own, because that is a huge ticket item for the city of Winnipeg, and we do want to have increased focus on that as we move forward.
What's the cost of adding another committee?
You know what, it is really about realignment, so there is a juggling, but I don't anticipate any significant costs. The question could be framed as, what are the costs for not having a focus on addressing the strategic priorities of council and of Winnipeggers? And that's really what this is intending to do, is to make sure that we are we're seeing the big picture about increased focus on getting the right job done at City Hall.
I apologize if I didn't catch it in the press release, but have you said he's going to be the chair speaking?
No, that decision is for another day. This is really about just the realignment of the standing committees.
You mentioned it's been a year
for
yourself and the council. Yeah. Is there anything in the first year you didn't get done that you said, gee, I really wanted to get that done in the first year? Is there something, is there a big ticket item or something small that, is there something that you wish these I wish we'd got that, just too much to do? Or?
I wish the Jets would have gone further in the playoffs, but no, you know what? We had a very strong start to this new council, and I'm very pleased that we've increased the focus on openness and transparency, unprecedented openness and transparency. I mentioned in the meeting some of the accomplishments to date. There's still much more work to do, but unprecedented access to capital expenditures, now monthly reporting online for all citizens, including in machine-readable format, significantly greater openness and transparency on FIPA matters, proactively publishing all published FIPA requests. We've got lots more to do. I've been posting my appointments and meeting schedule online proactively, as well as live streaming EPC meetings. And there's a lot more in store in the coming year. So on openness and transparency, I think we're off to a very strong start. Fixing the roads, that is something I'm particularly proud of. $103.3 million in road renewal, historic levels for road repair. I think you can see it when you drive around town now with the amount of fresh asphalt in pretty much every area of the city. It equates to over 130 kilometers of road repair that is accounted for in that line item. And that's significant road renewal. We've got a lot more to do after 14 years of property tax cuts and freezes. You just have to look around town to see the state of disrepair of our infrastructure. So we've got a lot of work to do, but we're off to a strong start in that respect.
Is it at governance, or have you, I thought that's where it was going, but this is a long time since I've asked. Have you abandoned, you wanted EPC elected by council. Where is that at, or have you abandoned that?
Well, the overall commitment that I made was to increase the collaboration with all members of council, and we've done that. We have had two committees that have been a part of hiring committees. One was for the hiring of our new CAO. The other is ongoing right now for an auditor comprised of non-EPC members. We have a budget working group that is currently comprised predominantly of non-EPC members. We've had more council seminars than probably in the first year than the previous council had. I mean, significant amount of collaboration. As I mentioned in June, we looked at this when I first came in and looked at the charter. It's not something that I would support, and I indicated that this past June.
You don't want to push. I was just going to say, you kind of pushed to really just change the charter.
Well, like I said, I mean, the overall intent is to build a more collaborative council, and we're onto a strong start to do just that.
But why haven't you given up the steps?
Why give up the electing members?
Well, like I said, there's been other mechanisms that I've been leveraging to increase collaboration and also to increase the input from non-EPC members to important decision-making that's happening, and that has happened already to date.
So you don't think it's needed anymore?
Well, I indicated back in June. It's not something that I would support, and it's primarily because we found, and we, as I promised, there is a commitment to increasing collaboration amongst all members of council, and really pulling in the insights and the passions of our members of council. And I think the first year we were off to a strong start in that respect, and there's other things that I'll be doing over the course of the next year to continue to try to leverage the expertise and the passions of all members of council.
So do you consider that a regret, or how would you characterize? I mean, you know, you had an idea. Mm-hmm. You're now into an alternative. How do you characterize what the alternative is?
Well, I think if you take a look at what we inherited, I mean, let's take a look at the dynamic that you all reported on over a year ago. It was a council that had much more crisis than collaboration, and we have moved in the right direction to build a more collaborative, a more professional working environment here at City Hall. And that campaign commitment was really to move us in that direction. And that's what we've done. As you know, when we took office, we had legal take a look at it in terms of what is permitted in the charter. And we worked within those rules. And because we've actually been making significant headway on a number of the areas I've just listed, as I mentioned back in June, I mean, it's not something that I support.
I gotta say that there is a huge reluctance in City Hall to go to the province and get the charter changed for whatever reason. I mean, is it something where you just see a roadblock at the province where it's just like, oh God, we're not gonna spend our time going down there and asking them to change this thing?
I disagree with you. I mean, we actually have worked with the province to amend the charter in the first year, including whistleblower protection.
Okay.
So we have had we've had constructive dialogue, and we've delivered results already with the working with the province in more collaborative fashion to make changes to the charter.
Mr. Keel asked you, is there things that you would have done, could have done, should have done? And that's, again, do you have any regrets? Is there a year of the things that you really wish you could have taken back?
No, I don't have any regrets. There are things that we've got a lot of work to do. We've just started. It's tomorrow will be 1 year. And I think if citizens look at the City Hall as it's functioning now compared to the City Hall we inherited, I think they've seen us move in the right direction. But we've got a lot of work to do, and so the next 3 years we'll continue to be busy, and we'll continue to focus on addressing the priorities of Winnipeggers.
So the likely question after that is, what's the big one for the second year? What tell us what you on zone high on your wish list?
Well, the number one priority is increased and ongoing investments in infrastructure, notably road infrastructure. I can't tell you how happy I am when I drive down Portage Avenue or Pembina Highway or Henderson and drive on fresh asphalt. And I know Winnipeggers have been reaching out to me, certainly after, as the construction season is slowly winding down, to thank us for historic levels of funding for road infrastructure. And that will continue to be a focus. We'll continue to focus on openness and transparency. We inherited a City Hall that was not open and transparent, and we've got a long way to go, but we were off to a very strong start.
So you said no regrets. Does that include the dispute you had with Mark Chipman, True North, and Senator Mitcher?
I think I've already answered that question.
Well, you know, during when all that came out, both True North and Senator Mitcher released tons of documents which showed that your office, your staff, knew more about the project than you had let on. And so basically Mark Chipman called a news conference to call you a liar in public, said that your chief of staff, your senior administration, and yourself all knew about the True North Square project, which you had denied in January.
Well, I think I've addressed that previously.
Well, let's, no, I don't believe you ever have.
Do you want me to answer the question?
Yes, please.
Okay, well, if you could not interrupt me, I'll answer that.
Okay.
I think I previously addressed that. There was a significant amount of information that we didn't have, and we are moving forward. We've had very productive discussions since then, and the question was, do I have any regrets? And the answer is no.
Okay.
Go ahead, please.
Okay, it's a new topic.
Yeah,
sure. Okay. The change to reporting on major projects worth 20 million or more instead of 10 million or more. I'm just trying to square, there was a concern raised in the meeting to Council why this is less transparency and we used that more. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think we addressed those concerns. I mean, we are moving with unprecedented openness and transparency. Whether it's $1 or $21 million, we are reporting every month now on every single capital expenditure. And you can go online right now and see the latest report when it comes to capital expenditures. And so all of that information is out in a way that's never been done before in the history of this city. It's also put out in machine-readable format, and that's something I'm very proud of, and we're moving in the right direction.
Previously, the city of Winnipeg embarked on a fire hall expansion program, and the reason that the public and political people didn't see anything about it is because they broke it up into chunks so that it didn't exceed a $10 million cap. Now we got a $20 million cap, and some would argue that you could divide projects into, well, we'll do the road work, and then we'll do the sewer work, and then we'll do the this, and each piece will add up to less than 20 million bucks, and we're good to go. I mean, you see what I'm saying here is that openness and transparency may push up against an increase in a cap.
Well, I mean, look, let's be mindful of the fact that the threshold has been moved to account for inflation, and then that's all that motion is doing. We do have a new position being created for a chief project management officer. The main reason that initiative is so positive is the fact that quite often what we've seen in previous councils and even what we've seen since the election, since we've been here, is that finance, quite often information comes to council through finance. There needs to be increased coordination between departments, between finance and public works, for instance, to ensure that there is someone accountable for making sure the right hand and the left hand understands and can report on information to council and to the public. And so that position is really important. But I think also, every dollar that's being spent on capital expenditures is going to be posted online before. That's never been done, and that information can be looked at, whether it's in small pieces or large ticket items. It's all going to be online for everyone, including all of you, to analyze and raise questions. And that's exactly what we actually want to see. We want to have members of council, we want to have the public, we want the media looking through information that we're proactively putting forward to help us collectively better identify areas of concern.
Can you clarify what is happening or what is not happening with the parole motion? Because it's on the governance committee, but you didn't, if my understanding is correct, EPC didn't say, hey, let's get governance to do a report on it to send the motion to council as is, or?
I believe governance recommended receiving it as information.
Okay.
And what EPC did today was concur with governance.
So there's not going to be a push to say move that July meeting to the end of July, it's status quo, because the parole really does begin July 31st. Like,
yeah,
I understand, but to Russ White's point, if we have a meeting in the middle of July, it backs up everything else. I mean, do you have that concern? I mean, it doesn't seem like anything's really changing.
You know what, on this one, I mean, there isn't a day off when you're mayor. And so for me, I know that, Jeff. I certainly, I'm working, pretty much 24/7. And so the timing of the meetings is something that we'll defer to council. It was the previous council who decided on the meeting schedule that we inherited. And council will decide on the meeting schedule going forward. I think the concerns that are raised are appropriate to be raising, and let's try to find a schedule that works best for members of the public and for council.
So there will be changes to that schedule then? Is that like
ultimately that's up to council. Council meets and goes through the schedule on an annual basis. I haven't attended one of those meetings yet because we inherited the previous schedule.
Next year's council meeting, if you heard that, is still July 13th, right? Did I hear that right?
I'd have to get back to you on that, and the clerks could probably help with that as well. Yeah.
Right.
I am a little lost.
I'm out now.
Yes. Okay, well, I think I've covered it all. Oh, yeah. We're talking about money and debt and financing stuff, and today sort of slipped through really fast, but yet another project the city is involved with, which is the Garden City Soccer, indoor soccer complex, is over budget. And the way of dealing with the financing on that is a loan guarantee, which, thank heaven, the interest rates are so low, but, I mean, your comments on, yeah, it's more money. There isn't a project we seem to do that isn't, well, it is more money.
I'll let our finance chair speak to loan guarantee on that one.
Okay.
If there
it's
are,
a general question, but just about the ability to get a number and stick to it, or the process. I mean, I've talked to your finance chair about how these things start as estimates, and then they waver and they move around and stuff. But nothing ever comes in on time, nothing budget, I'm afraid.
Well, first phase of rapid transit came in on time and on budget.
Fair enough.
I wish I could take credit for that, but I can't. Because that predates me. But there are some things that come in on time and on budget, and I look forward to positive reports when that happens from all of you. But the focus for us in the first year was really to ensure that we're getting all the information we can to make informed decisions specifically address that concern, because there's a finite amount of taxpayers' money that we are entrusted to manage, and we want to make sure that we're getting as much information as quickly as possible. The capital expenditure reporting is one very important and unprecedented step to help us with exactly that dynamic. But this may be a good segue to let you speak with our finance chair.
Okay.
Wish you guys
Thank
all
you.
A good day.
Thank you very much,
thanks.
Mr. Mayor.
And I would invite all of you will you guys be at the Small Business Summit tomorrow? That's if you want to know what we're doing to celebrate the 1 year anniversary. Celebrating the 1 year anniversary tomorrow of the election with the Small Business Summit. So this is a campaign commitment of mine to meet with the small business community to hear from them on how we can make better use of the funds that they send here through the small business tax, and so through the business tax. And so we'll be spending the morning with the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce and a number of members from our small business community to hear from them how we can provide better value for the money that they send here.
Do you have a press release on that?
If you haven't received one yet,
that would be helpful to keep track of it.
Yeah,
okay.
The Small Business Summit is something I'm really excited about. This
Chamber Day?
I think that.
Okay.
Oh, the Chamber definitely. They are hosting it. But I mean, as you know, I mean, we raised the threshold in the last budget. We also increased the small business tax rate. And that being said, I want to hear from the business community, and we have senior members, including Doug McNeil of our public service, that will be there to provide information to the business community. And it's all about increasing the dialogue, increasing the accessibility, and making sure we're delivering better value for businesses that send a lot of money here. So that's tomorrow. That'll be a good way to mark the 1 year anniversary. So have a great day.
We'll bring
Yeah, thanks.